Hey guys, thanks for coming in tonight. Hello, replay viewers, and hey YouTube viewers, thanks for joining me here. YouTube viewers, if you'd like to join me live and participate in the chat, just download the Periscope app to your phone and search for Penguin and Fish. I'm here just about every night at 9:30 p.m. Central. So, all right, guys, we have a new block. You know, this is Sunday's new block, and I was not yesterday, so we are starting it today, full circle. So, all right, I'm going to flip you guys around, and we'll get going. Howdy! Hello, everyone. Hope you're doing well. Happy Monday. So, we are starting a new block, block 69 of the Splendid Sampler. It's called Full Circle by Holly DeGroot, and it is just so cute. I'm excited to work on it, and we're doing curves again, which I don't have much experience with. I mean, I get it. I know how to do them, but I just haven't put in the hours and hours and hours of practice, so this will be good for me. I'm going to flip you around and we'll get started. Hopefully, I think we can get pretty far in this tonight. If you're new here, my name is Alyssa Thomas from Penguin and Fish, where we make lovely and quirky hand embroidery patterns and kits. I'm the author of Sew and Stitch Embroidery and a fabric designer, and I'm here every night at 9:30 p.m. Central. And I wasn't here yesterday or the night before because we were painting our living room all weekend. You can kind of see it right there. It's all white and a white ceiling. I'll get into why we had to do all that in a sec here, and I'll show you it in about a week or so. We'll have a new bookshelf up there, and then it'll be clean. So, all right, guys, I'm going to flip you around and we'll get going. All right, here we go tonight. So let's get started. So what this basically consists of is a couple template sheets where we match up these different points here. And we're going to use both of these twice. So it's the top half is this, and one solid piece of fabric for that. And then the bottom half is, again, this shape right here, template B. And then we're going to sew a bunch of strips together. So we have to cut some strips tonight, and we'll cut our template pieces here. And then after we sew all our strips together, then we do the same thing that we did up here, a curve. And then we sew the whole thing together. I'm kind of excited. I think it's really, really pretty. They do have a paper piecing option. We're going to do it the normal pieced way. And I have my, here's this guy. I got this sewing machine back. So even though I want to try and play with the old Singer a little bit more, like how we have been, I thought I'd give this guy a test drive. I have not started him up since I got him back from the shop. So we'll use the old sewing machine tonight. So anyway, let's get going, I think, with these template pieces. This is what I'm thinking for fabric. I thought I'd do this cloud background just because it's clouds, which I think would be cool. I'm trying to kind of think of this as like a floating moon, kind of. And, you know, so we got a cloudy sky, our dark moon cloudy sky. And I thought the top circle, top half of the circle, could be this white and black. We haven't really showcased this on its own, and I think it's worth it. It's just such a pretty fabric. It's just really crisp and clean, and I kind of like it. And it, you know, it would work for a half moon. And then I thought, you know, we're bringing in the blues again because I'm trying to get a lot of blues in my Splendid Sampler quilt. So I thought we'd trade off these two guys here. I thought they were light enough that they would pop off the background, and that was what I was worried about. I didn't want it to completely blend into the background. Like, if they were too dark, they'd get lost in the background. So I think these are light enough, and then the white, I think, still pops on it, and we're still getting this kind of blue vibe still. So those were my parameters, I suppose, when I was looking through fabrics. So I'm going to start by just cutting out these template pieces. Oh yeah, so this is what it'll look like when we're done here. So I'm just grabbing that template piece out of here. There we go. Set these guys aside. And I am going to just trim these out. And we'll trace these onto our fabric. And when we trace, I'm also going to put our marker points as well. Because that's what will match up to these. So yeah, so originally, you know, we painted our living room this weekend, which was kind of fun. I don't think we've ever done a house project just for the sake of making it pretty. We've had to do house projects because, you know, something went wrong or something, but not just to make something pretty. But I guess it started with kind of two factors. So one, we had a leak in our roof, which is fine now. We got that all fixed, but it left a stain on the ceiling in the living room. So we're like, ah, we got to get rid of that. And the other thing was, is that we used to have a big bookshelf in our living room, but then we moved it because my husband shot part of his short film in the living room. And just because we wanted to, yeah. He shot part of his short film in the living room. So we had moved, this is like a year or so ago, we had moved all our books and that bookshelf out of that room. And then we ended up rearranging it, and the bookshelf wouldn't work there again the way we were doing it. Like, we were able to put books on both sides of the shelf, but now we had it up against the wall, so it wasn't really holding all our books anymore. So it just wasn't working. We're using it for something else in the house. But I wanted to put a shelf on the wall, something that would take up the whole wall and use up all of our bookshelves. But that's white, so that was, and that's something that is coming in on this coming Sunday. So it's white, and we need to paint it. So the wall's white to go with the shelf, and we need to paint the ceiling because of the paint stain, and it's just something we wanted to do. We hate the color. We didn't like the color of the room. We didn't hate it, but we do a lot of film stuff in there, like shooting little YouTubes and stuff like that, and just, you know, shooting some video and interviews with other people and that sort of thing. And it had this mauve-y colored background, and it just didn't look good behind people. It just looked weird. And, you know, sometimes I do photo shoots and stuff for, like, a quilt. I'll hang a quilt on the wall or something, and that mauve background just wasn't working. So now we have a bright white background on three of our walls, and I'm waiting for the bookshelf, and then all our books can live somewhere again, and that'll be nice because we have books scattered in piles all over the house yet from when we took them down for that movie. So I'm excited. So that was the reason for the painting. All right, I gotta plug in my iron. I think I'm gonna spray starch everything right from the get-go. Okay. So let's do the pressing first. I probably don't need to use spray starch when I press this, but it is going to be part of all those, you know, we are going to be sewing it to a bunch of pieces and the arcs and stuff. It might be good just to give it a little more sturdiness, so I think I'm going to do that. We did still end up painting a wall black, so three walls in our living room are white, and then we have a little entryway, and we painted that a light gray, and then we painted the wall opposite the entryway, so you walk in, and then there's a wall there. We painted that wall black, and it's, like, full-on black, and we did that because we were just kind of talking about it, and then we're like, okay, we like that idea, we're just going to do it. We did it because that's the wall that our kind of TV just sets, it sits on a bench in front of that wall, and we're like, oh, what if we painted it black, and then it'll look like the TV, when the TV's off, it won't look like we have a TV, it'll just be black, and the wall will be black, so at first glance, it'll just be, like, nice and clean and without a TV. And that's what we did, just kind of for fun. And it totally worked. Like, when the TV's off, I mean, clearly you can tell that there's a TV there, but at first glance, you know, when you're just in the room, it's not like, here's a mauve wall with a black TV shouting off of it. It just so blends in. And you know what? It's so funny. I mean, when we were painting the white, first of all, the white was so bright compared to this mauve that we had. Everything just was so light all of a sudden. And then we painted this black, and the black was a little difficult for it to go on. Like, it took a million coats, and I don't know, it was just weird. And we were tired. It was already like midnight by the time we started that, or it was at least like 11 when we started, once we finished the white walls, and then moved on to the black. But I think we were both pretty nervous, while we were, I need to figure out what way I want to cut this. Let's just start this, start with this. Oh, a dark primer. Yeah, you know what? We decided to skip the primer and just do a couple coats of the black, and that did fine. You know, yeah, black primer probably would have been a good idea. All right, we need two of these, so let's just start here, and then we'll work up to the strips. Ooh, this is really messing. These black and whites are really messing with, there we go. It's kind of blowing out the screen a lot. But yeah, it took a lot of layers for it to go on, and but we're really happy with it. And what was so funny is that we were kind of both freaking out a little, not freaking out, but we were all both a little nervous about the black when we were painting it on. But now that we have some of our furniture back in there, it is so warm. Like, it's weird to explain because we wouldn't have thought this. I don't know if this is gonna, I don't know if I'm gonna be able to see this pen on here. No, I think I'm gonna use a pencil. But it makes the house or the living room just feel nice and cozy and warm in there with the black. And I don't know why that is, but the black is so what makes it like homey. It's just kind of unexpected. So I think we were both nervous about the black, but did it anyway. And now I think we're really happy with it. So we're not quite done yet. Like, I'm waiting for that shelf yet, and then we can finally get the books out of, like, stacked up in the bedroom. There's just stacks and stacks of books in the bedroom, and we've gone through them already a little bit. We just need a shelf for it. So that's coming on Sunday, and then after that, oh, and then we're gonna get a wall mount for the TV, so it'll be, like, floating on the wall, so it'll be even more, like, it disappears when it's off. And then we gotta hang up art and stuff yet. But after that, then it's done. But it definitely feels better, and already it's so much brighter with the white. A young couple's room. It's better with the white as well, because it's just so sunny, so much sunnier in there. It's more reflective, which is what we wanted it for. Like, we're gonna shoot, you know, I can shoot, like, put little still lifes together or whatever, or product photos or something like that, and I can shoot it in the bright, sunny room. So I'm excited for that. But it was our first foray into doing something just to be pretty, I guess. That wasn't just because we, you know, had to. But we've been doing a lot of that stuff lately because we had the basement that we did too, where we just, I wonder if I can fit this in here. Nah, not quite. Let's go like this. I'm trying to not waste this fabric. Maybe I should go. I think like this. But yeah, so we're still getting the basement cleaned up, but the walls fixed. Oh, hello from South Australia. I have my brother and his girlfriend are there. But yeah, so the basement's walls we've been working on, and they're all ready to go. I know other parts of the house, but it's just, I'm exhausted. Like, I don't know how people, like, just want to do this all the time. Like, I don't know. There's people that love painting walls and stuff, but ugh, God. It was fine, and I guess it only took a weekend, but still, it took a full weekend. And, you know, moving all the crap and putting it back, and we're not done putting it back. The nice thing about putting it back is that you can go through stuff and get rid of stuff and all that, but, I mean, you gotta full-on dedicate your time to it because you're not getting anything else done that day or that weekend. So I'm doing the lines in pencil. They're probably pretty hard to see. Once I'm done tracing them on, I'll show you up close. I tried the water-soluble marker, and that's what I'll use for the other things, I think, the other fabrics, because I know I'll be able to see it, but this fabric's so dark, and there's no right or wrong side to it. It's a batik. So I just couldn't see the markings, and I needed to see it somehow, so I can see it with the pencil. I think I did it there, yeah. So let me zoom in. On the YouTube, you can probably see it a little bit. Let me see if I can get in here. There, do you kind of see them here? So those are my pencil marks. So I'm going to cut those out now. Oh, you see it? Okay, good. Yeah, I just knew, okay, well, my water erasable marker wasn't working, so pencil has that sheen to it, and it's not going to matter because we're cutting it right on the line, and you know what? I want to put the markings in. So let's think about this for a sec. Is it the light or is there a color? Oh yeah, there is color. So this is a batik. So I think they probably dyed the fabric all this crazy, it's like a bunch of different colors. It's like a purple and a little green and some gold and yellow and orange and a little bit of light blue. It's like all sorts of colors. So my guess is, I mean, I don't know much about batiks, but my guess is that they colored the fabric all the colors in there, and then they drew with something like a wax, basically something like that. Someone tell me if I'm totally off on this, but drew on it with a wax all these shapes, and then dyed over the whole thing again with this really dark blue. It's kind of a blue and a black together, and then you get rid of the wax, and then it's like a resist, so it left all that pretty color underneath. But I think that'd be fun to try, and it keeps changing. Like, I go from bright pink skin to yellow skin just because the phone keeps trying to adjust. So let's think about this for a sec, because this has markings on here. You know, I gotta move this out of the way while we talk. It just isn't working. There we go. Okay, so this has markings on it for that will match up when we sew. So we'll be going kind of like this, twisting, but making sure that we have these marks next to each other. And I'm looking at where these marks are positioned, and I think all we need to know about them, I think we can just like drag them to the edge at like a 90 degree or like perpendicular to the edge, because I don't think these match exactly to these, because if that's the case, this dot would be to the inside of this our line, just like how it is here. You see what I'm saying? So I think this probably just represents mark the edge, like right on that point there. or, you know, actually it's probably more so like mark it at the seam allowance, actually. That's probably where we really want those dots to match up. Like we want to, when we sew, we want our sew line to match up. So that would be at that, that quarter inch seam allowance. So, you know, tell me if I'm wrong on this, but I think that's what we want to meet up is actually those dots. So what I'm going to do is just kind of mark where they are perpendicular to it on the fabric. And then when we get ready to pin these together, I will just, well, you know, as I mark, I'll just go back like a, and I'll estimate like a quarter of an inch and mark that as well. So let's cut these out and then give that a try. So let's see, here we are. I'm going to cut these all out by hand. I suppose I could use the rotary cutter on these straight shapes, but there's no need to really. I'm going to cut both out at the same time. And it was kind of fun when we painted. I don't know if you guys saw my Instagram, but we just got a projector, like a refurbished projector, because John's going to use it for his cast and crew screening. And to rent one was only a little less than buying a refurbished one. And we it's one of those things that we would use a lot, like, you know, to do films outside and just that sort of thing. So we decided to get one. And we had its debut of... We used it for the first time when we painted our walls. For our first wall, we painted white where the bookshelf's gonna be, and then we had the idea to do that. So we got the projector out and put it on a stool, and we projected. I think we watched Weekend at Bernie's. We just projected on the wall while we were painting over that wall, and then we also watched Major League, which I hadn't seen in a long time, and it's still funny. But yeah, so that was neat. So we were watching movies on our, basically our white movie screen wall and painted forever. I think we didn't get to bed till like 2:30, but we got it all done on Saturday, basically. And then on Sunday in the light of day, we could see all of the parts that needed a second coat and, or a third coat or fourth coat. And, little detail stuff, so that actually took all of Sunday as well, and then, you know, and then just cleaning up and everything took forever, and we were tired, so it just took forever anyway. But man, we haven't had a weekend like that where we just do nothing but a house thing, so that was just kind of new for us, I suppose. We didn't have to do anything to the house when we moved in here. It was just rehabbed, and they put all generic everything in. Hence the creamy mauve living room. All right. Almost done here, I think. It's kind of weird trying to cut both these out at the same time, but... Oh, we also started a new show. You know, we've been without a show for a while. Like, we'll binge watch some like series, and then we'll be like, oh, we can't start binge watching another one of those until we do. And so we started another one while we were painting, or while we were cleaning up and doing stuff on Sunday. We started Better Call Saul, which is that spin-off series from Breaking Bad that follows the lawyer from Breaking Bad. It's awesome so far. We like it. So we're sucked into another one. Have you seen that one? Oh, you've heard of it. Yeah, I mean, I knew it was around, and I knew, you know, people liked it and stuff, but we just had never started. I mean, we've seen all the Breaking Bads. Man, we might have seen the Breaking Bads as they were coming out. No, I don't know. Maybe we've binge... I think we might have binge-watched all that, too. Or just seen, like, a couple episodes here and there when it was on, because we didn't have... I think that's HBO, and we didn't have HBO. And then we got HBO to go much later, and I think that's when we binge-watched them. Or they were on Netflix or something. I think they're on Netflix. I think that's where we watched them. But yeah, so we hadn't seen that for a while, so it's just kind of funny to jump in again and remember characters. Like, oh yeah, that guy. I know, Gilmore Girls, that's November, right? Probably Thanksgiving, that seems like a logical time for thing to release something. But it's November, right? I think November at some point. Yes, I want to watch that too. All the previews are so fun. That was my last binge watch. Oh yeah. I would definitely recommend Breaking Bad first. I mean, you know what? I mean, we talked about that. You probably wouldn't need it, but I think Breaking Bad is like the superior show so far. I mean, that is such a good I mean, like, you know, it's gory and, you know, all this stuff, but the acting and everything, it's like a perfect pair, like Batman and Robin, or like any pair, like Abbott and Costello, like it's like a perfect pair, these two characters. And if you like Bryan Cranston, then it's awesome. And it's just, you know, you wouldn't have to watch Better Call Saul first, but you would probably prefer to watch The Breaking Bad first. I mean, it's worth it. I mean, I know it's super duper long, and it's kind of crazy, and it gets pretty, like, nuts, like, hard to watch sometimes, but it's so good. Like, as far as storytelling and all that, I mean, it's kind of worth it. But yeah, you could watch, I'm thinking you could probably watch Better Call Saul without it. They do a good job of, you know, making it its own thing. Alright, here's this guy. Let's trace him quick, and then I'll put all the markings in. They're just shot so well, too. Like, interesting camera angles, interesting ways to introduce story bits. Like, it always leaves you like, oh my gosh, this beginning, where are they now, what's going on here, you know? It's just clever and fun to watch. I've never seen Justified. I've heard of that, but I don't know anything about it, actually. You're having baby now? Like, for reals? Alright, here we go. So let's cut that out first, and then we'll do the markings. Yeah, seriously, congrats. Oh my gosh, crazy. This was, the baby boy, right? Very exciting, good luck. Awesome. You'll have to make a new quilt. Oh, that'll be nice. No, not periscoping. Not periscoping it. I could totally see someone doing that. Exciting. Sending good, happy vibes to the fam. That's really exciting. There are no babies in our me and my brother's family yet, so we haven't had an experience all that yet. Alright, here we are. I'm going to just mark these. So I'm going to mark right on the edge where these perpendicular lines are, and then I'll go in the quarter inch and do it a little, that extra little dot. Oh, yep, it's a new cutting mat. I actually had, I'm going to just go in like a quarter inch. I'm going to just guess. I had a bunch of cutting mats, and this one I wasn't using anymore because it's cut through in some places, or it's just like really cut up, but where I need it, it works out perfectly. And it's a lot cleaner and it's a lot flatter than the other one. My other one has a wobble in it, and it's been annoying to cut on here sometimes. So, all right, oh yeah, it's brighter. It's kind of like that horrible kind of green color, but it kind of matches my sewing machine a little bit. So I just marked the points there, and then I went in a quarter of an inch and marked those points. That I think those are the actual points that we're going to try and match up. So let's do the same on these two guys. And why don't we try and finish this top half? So instead of piecing everything tonight, let's sew a curve. Let's do this curve first. This will be like our practice curve. And then I'm not going to be here tomorrow. On Wednesday, tomorrow's my painting class. So I'll do a little mini scope at the end of painting class. But on Wednesday, we'll piece the bottom part together. You know, we did this cutting. This is kind of what takes a while. And then we'll try and finish the whole thing then, hopefully. All right, let's get these points in. So now these I'll have to do with a pencil again. Here we are. Which is a little difficult to see, but it's easier to see than that water-soluble marker on here. All right, oh gosh, it's really hard to see. Okay, right, here's the first one. So I'm just gonna put kind of a big dot right there. Just going like perpendicular to I can't see that one at all, to the edge. Oh, because it's up here. I was thinking it's down here somewhere. Be about right there. There, now I can see it. So I'm just, going 90 degrees angle from kind of where the arc is at this point and just doing a quarter inch. So, all right, let's try pinning this together. This is where we do that easing and all that. So right sides together. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to put a pin. Ooh, you know what? Wonder Clips might work with this too, but we're going to try pinning it first. So I'm going to put a pin kind of at that scant quarter and then do kind of what we've been doing with the paper piecing. I'm going to just go through this quarter inch mark there. Flip that around. And let's just kind of line up that mark, get it kind of centered. So, you know, I don't want it off like this. I want it kind of the opposite of this. And let's throw a pin in there now. Ooh, leave for a cruise on Sunday. That's exciting. Oh, wow. These are new pins. They are really thick. I don't think I'm going to use those. Let's get back to these thin pins. Thin pins are so nice. So I'm just pinning it right at where the seam is as well, or the seam allowance, that quarter inch. I think that'll be helpful later. So now we're going to leave that pin in, and we're going to move up to this next dot and do the same thing. Ooh, Bahamas, that sounds so nice. It's been getting chilly here, and I've seen a few people that have snow already. In their like Instagrams and stuff. That's unpleasant. All right, so same thing here. I'm going to kind of repeat the arcs that are happening and putting a pin right in there. And same thing here. First cruise! Ooh, fun! Are you going on any stops along the way? Like, are you going, snorkeling! That's the thing. Oh, still 70s in Illinois. That's nice. Actually, today it was just gorgeous out. We had all the windows open today, but this weekend it was chilly. I think we have one nice week, and then it gets, I think it starts to get chilly again. Is this my mark here? It looks kind of funny, but it must be it. Yeah, that's it. Okay. So let's get this arch together, and then we'll start pinning everywhere in between. Oh, you are going to Nassau. Oh, yay! Oh my goodness. That sounds so lovely. I hope you have a wonderful trip. Right, this one's wiggly on me. Those will just pin right where it wants to lay. Woo, Caribbean cruise, that sounds nice too. All right, so now we have to kind of do our easing thing where we're just gonna pin in the middle, and we're going to keep pinning until there are just oodles and oodles of pins over this whole thing. Oh, cute! That's nice! That's sweet. Alright, so I'm going to throw a pin right in the middle here. Again, I'm kind of putting the pins at the quarter-inch seam allowance. And if anything looks weird with what I'm doing, yell at me and tell me how to do it right. Because again, I've done, you know, curves for like doing stuffed animals and things like that before, but I don't know, it always feels a little different. And I'm not always using quilting weight fabric for that either, so there's not much forgiveness. In curves, when you're using quilting weight fabric. So I'm gonna throw the ends together. It doesn't have like stretch, or it's not like, you know, fleece where it's stretchy and fuzzy. So, you know, like if you're making a stuffed animal or something, that hides a lot of mistakes. And when you're doing stuffed animals with curves and stuff like this, you're most of the time doing different shapes to create like three dimension with curves and piece in quilting here, we're ending up with two dimensions again. All right, this one's a little wobblier. We'll have to add another pin to that one for sure. So it is a lot of pinning for these curves, at least the way I do it. I don't know any tricks, just doing this. So I'm going to pin through all of these again. I wouldn't call this hard though, if you're passing it, because it seems a little difficult. It's just, you know, it just takes time. This isn't necessarily hard doing all this pinning. It's just pinning. And luckily it's not, there's not much more to it than this either. So it's not like we're doing like 800 arcs or something like that, that all have to go together. Just two big arcs, and one of the arcs is piece, which I think is gonna be really cute. I'm excited for that part. I think it's good to do this half first to kind of practice practice, because when the piece side is going to want to stretch and move a little bit more than this side, just because it's got sewn pieces together, the edges might want to pull apart and stuff like that. So we have to just be a little bit more delicate with that one. All right, let's just good measure print pin one more here. Okay, and I'm ready to sew, although now that I look at it, I'm not sure if they put any, if my bobbin is in here or not. I'll have to find it. So, all right, when we sew this, let me think. I think I'm gonna go in this direction. So I'm kind of stretching this bottom piece a little bit while, you know, I'm extending the arc a little bit, like I'm pulling on the arc, because, you know, this piece right now is actually flipped like this. So by pulling on it a little, I'll be able to match it up with this top piece. So when I sew, I'm just going to flatten it out as I go, keep to that quarter inch. I'll back tack it too and just go slowly all the way around. That's all I'm going to do. So let's head over here back to the sewing machine. Let's hope it works. I do have to thread it, it looks like. Let's see what is in there for the bobbin. Okay, so my bobbin's still there. I left that for them, so that's good. Get that threaded. So they also cleaned it all up and checked the tension and everything like that. So that's good. Makes my machine happy. You know what? I'm gonna do. I have a tan bobbin in here. I don't think I have my gray one nearby. No, I took it out when I brought it to them, but I don't know where it is. But I'm gonna use gray on top. So just because I think the gray goes really well with. With all this, I don't know if I can get, you guys can't really see me thread it. It's kind of a weird angle. But I like this gray. So we'll see how that goes. I hope machine's happy now. Gray goes with everything. Here, basically my whole wardrobe is gray, if you haven't noticed. I wear a lot of gray. I don't know, I mean, that word used to be like that, so I don't know. I think it's just simple. I know, I like that. All right, let's grab my little scissors. Pop that thread out. All right. We're ready to go. You know what? Let's do a little test on our ender. Let's get that going. Ooh, feels good. It feels comfortable. So let's just take a look quick. Yeah, I think it's good enough to just get started. Let me try one more, I think. It's kind of hard to tell on there. I think maybe we'll just make, well, it's kind of sad to use this piece. I think I can use the middle part of this some more, so I'm just gonna trim these little ends. So I can save this piece of it yet, but I'll sew these two tiny pieces together and see if it works, see how the tension is. Should be perfect, since they just checked it all. Yeah, it's pretty good here. So, let's turn this off so you guys can see. So there's the stitching. Yeah, it does sound better. It doesn't sound so chunky, does it? All right, so I can't see any of the thread popping out on either side, so I'm thinking the tension is just right, which is good, good, good. Yeah, it sounded smoother, didn't it? So they said that there was like a little short in the cord, so they left my pedal, but completely replaced the cord. So I have a modern cord now and my old pedal still. I'm gonna get my stiletto out for this too. This will help me guide my fabric along. And then they cleaned it as well. And they said that that's probably why the foot was getting warm, because I was going to ask about that, you know, because my foot pedal was getting just really warm. And, you know, it's not warm at all now, even though, well, I suppose I just turned this on too. So I haven't been sewing this whole time. All right, I'm getting it in there, kind of at the scant quarter marking. Oh, you know what? Let's get the, I don't know. Yeah, here it is. I'm going to put my walking foot back on. So they, you know what? Let's not use the walking foot. I'm using just a, just the normal zigzag foot, I think. Although I'm not as familiar with the scant quarter on it, where that lies. So we'll just see how this goes. So I'm going to take the pins out as I go. Put the pin cushion up there. Ah, no, that's gonna be my way. I'll throw it down here. Just because I don't want to sew over the pin. So the difference between this foot, presser foot, and my walking presser foot, which is this big, giant contraption, is that there's the feed dogs, which are underneath the machine, and they come up and pull the fabric along. They keep, like, with each stitch, they're moving the fabric along. So when I'm like this, it's kind of like front wheel drive versus all wheel drive. So, this, when I'm stitching right now on this other foot, only the bottom is going. So only the bottom feet is pulling it along. So the top is just kind of sliding through. But the bottom is being pulled along. With a walking foot, it pulls from the top as well. So it's doing it, bottom and the top are pulling it at the same time, which in theory makes everything match up better, because both pieces are being, the top and the bottom are being pulled at the same rate at the same time. Whereas here, only the bottom is being pulled and the top is just kind of sliding through, so you're hoping that it's just staying right. All right, so you can kind of see I'm holding this up a little bit, and that's just to kind of pull on that little arc, and I'm just guiding this arc along. We're just at the halfway point here. I'm hoping we can get through it without any puckers. So you're just going slow and steady, pulling out your pins, gradually turning. I'm thinking this is one of those things that you'd get used to if you had to do like 80 of them for a quilt, you know what I'm saying? All right, so here we go, and I'm just gonna back tack it again. Oh, it's a lot of pinning. That's where we're at, and look, I think we've got a pretty big pucker here actually too, so let's take a look at that and see what we could have done maybe a little bit better. So I can already tell that I'm going to get some puckers in here. That's not too bad. So right here, though, is going to be a pretty big one. So I could, in theory, pull this out. It looks like it almost caught kind of funny. But let's just see how bad it is. So yeah, so there's the pucker. The rest looks decent. Here it looks like I could flatten it out. Yeah, this one I can steam out. So over here, I think we're good. And that just comes, like, when you're sewing, you got to kind of move it out of the way, the underneath fabric. You did a ring quilt over 3-inch skirt, a hole with archers. Yeah, that'd be tough. So I'm tempted to go in here and clip this one, and you know what, I think I might just do that, because I did grab a pretty big chunk of fabric there. It just is folded over a little bit. I don't know if you guys can see that. It's, you know, like a little zigzag folded over. And that's just because when I was sewing, it was all bunched up there. And instead of like being careful and moving stuff out of the way, I just sewed over it. So I'm going to just snip. We're going to give this a try. I don't know if this is going to really work. I'm going to just snip it. Oh, I suppose this is what I should use my seam ripper for. But I don't want to get rid of the whole seam. I'm just going to kind of open up that fold there. And I'm going to try and kind of rematch up some of these points. Let's do it. Check it here too. So I'm just pulling on it and I'm going to repin and I'm going to kind of back tack here and then just keep going. Let's see if that does the job. I'm going to pin from this side though. So let's start about right here. In theory, this should work. I don't know why this wouldn't work. We'll just back tack on top of some of the stitches that we already have. And that'll kind of lock everything in place. So this time I'm going to really kind of smooth this out. Have that fold be as far down and out of my way as possible. I'm going to throw a bunch of pins in here. Just to keep that out of my way. Oh, I've done this more than once. Oh, you've broken in the... Just cut open the seam just a little bit and restitched it. Yeah. Why bother doing the whole seam again where you'll probably make the same mistake? You know what I'm saying? Like, I would make this pucker somewhere else. So, all right. I think that's good. Let's just move it over a little bit more. There. And I'm going to start right there. So I've moved all that out of the way, I think. Let's give that a try. I'm going to actually try and go right after that pin. All right. Let's... back tack a little there, too, and... continue until we meet up with our seam again. All right, now we're on our old seam. Let's just back tack that a little and see how we did this time. hoping that worked. All right. Yeah, so that worked better. I sewed it a better quarter inch too, because the first time I was in a little bit far, so I can actually just pick those out a little bit. Okay, I don't see my seam ripper, so I'm just going to pick them out a little here. Just till it about meets up. One more. There we go. This side looks good. Let's open it up. Oh, I had one more. I had a little bit of the old seam. Like, it looks like my first time it might have caught a little. There we go. Now we're pulled out there. All right. Much better. So yeah, you can even see if I get really close here, you can see the holes where it did that little pucker. It went all the way up. So I sewed all the way up here and it grabbed all this whole entire chunk here. I can see the hole. So we definitely improved on that arch quite a bit. So yay, let's press this flat. And then we got our first arch done. So see, it's not so difficult. It's just lots of pinning, I think, is the key. Pinning, pinning, pinning. And we'll get to these, the other fabrics, when we come back on Wednesday. So I'm going to press from this side. You'll press towards the center, it's just where it's going to want to go. And so you might have heard that with curved seams, you have to like trim them, you have to like snip them and cut notches out of them. But when you're doing it so it ends up flat like this, you don't really have to. It's when you're like with stuffed animals and stuff, when it's ending up being a 3D shape or curve, or like where this is gonna have to flex like this. We should do something like that sometime. When the Splendid Sampler is done, maybe we'll try stitching a stuffed animal, and then we can really look at curves and shapes they make and all that. That might be kind of fun. So that's pretty interesting. All the ways flat things can become 3D shapes when you sew them together. It's just, I kind of really like that. All right. Oh, that looks great. Let's give it a good press on this side. So pretty. I'm liking it. Liking it a lot. But yeah, that'd be a fun project. Like a stuffed animal working with curves. All right, I'm really happy that we went back in and adjusted that, because now we have a really nice arch going. Like that's a good looking half circle, I think. A little wonky here and there, but not really. I'm feeling good about that circle. So, all right. I think that's all we'll do tonight. Tomorrow's my painting class, but on Wednesday, we'll come back in, do this patchwork. That'll be pretty quick. So we'll do, we can set this up underneath here. We'll do just patchwork with these two together. All we're doing is sewing a bunch of strips. So that shouldn't take too long. We'll have to cut it still. But then we'll do the same thing. We'll pin it up, do the circle. We already have this guy cut out, and this guy was a lot faster to cut out. And hopefully we'll finish on Wednesday. And then, you know, we'll get a new block on Thursday. But I'm digging it. I love that. I think this does look kind of like the moon in the dark evening sky. I'm going to like this one. All right, guys, I'm going to flip you around, and we will call it. Hey there. So thanks for sticking with me again here. There's the little half moon. I love it. I kind of actually really love it. I could see doing a whole quilt with circles just for the challenge of I'm going to do circles until I'm comfortable. You know what I mean? Like that would be a reason to do an all circle quilt. Even like a half circle quilt. Wouldn't this be cool just with a bunch of, I don't know, other ones right next to it? I don't know. It'd be kind of fun. But yeah, that's kind of the types of projects I like doing, is like, okay, I'm going to do this thing that I suck at, and I'm going to just do it until I figure it out, and I'm going to build a project around it, and I can see doing circles just for that. But all right, guys, I'll get this up on YouTube right now, so it'll be up by tomorrow morning. It'll be at Penguin and Fish Movies, and thanks so much for coming in, and good luck with the baby having, and let us know how it goes tomorrow. So, all right, guys, I will catch you, or not tomorrow, on Thursday. I'll be back here. Wednesday, I'll be back here. So have a great night, guys. See you later.